Thank you very much for that introduction. Once again, I'm honored to be here. It's always a privilege to be affiliated with OSAD and to be able to present and just to be part of this great organization moving forward. Today's talk is going to be on additive manufacturing on cost optimization of FDM produced products, also known as 3D printing. I will try to keep it as entertaining as possible, but my jokes tend to be a bit boring, as my wife tells me. Okay. So the scope of the presentation will cover what is additive manufacturing, the applications, the essential steps required to create products using additive manufacturing, different processes and technologies, process parameter, a cost formula that we developed, and design of experiment, and the results concluded to showcase for cost optimization. Okay, so what is additive manufacturing? So according to American Society of Testing Materials International, they define additive manufacturing as a process of joining material to make objects from 3D model data using layer upon layer process opposed to subtractive methodology. So in simple ways, and traditionally you would see that in subtractive manufacturing, you would see a block of material, a homogeneous material, which is then subtracted and reduced until you get a desired shape. Additive manufacturing, however, works opposite. It adds material as required to build a part. With that, gives us the ability to manipulate internal structures. And that is a very important aspect of our research. So how can we manipulate the internal structures with combination of other process parameters to reduce the cost of your parts? Keep in mind, these parts are not to be used as a functional parts. This is primarily for prototyping, for fit and feel type of testing. So in the early stages of design, just when you want to see how your parts look like, you might not want to invest a complete amount of money on something that's just a first prototype to see how it feels and fits. Here's an example of something that is considered as additive manufacturing. I'm not sure if you heard recently in Dubai, one company called Winson Construction from China produced a office made out of concrete. In 17 days, they were able to produce a complete functional office using layer upon layer process. This is an example of material extrusion based technology. So it's extruding layer of concrete, adding upon layer, as you can see, different steppings in the design. Some of the applications, well, 3D is one tool that really covers a variety of different applications. Whether you're from aerospace industry, or you're from animation, architecture, even food, biomedical, and some of the applications that are not even listed here. So there's many different type of applications that additive manufacturing covers. High-end restaurants, they're now using 3D printing to print out customized food, where you can have your proteins, your vitamins, all customized for your need. Bioprinters are printing out lungs, kidneys, hearts with human cells and tissues. Concept models are being produced with plastic, metal, and different type of photopolymers. So there's a variety of different range, and now the additive manufacturing is moving towards more functional pieces as well. So it's no longer restricted to just prototyping. You might have heard that GE has invested lots of money into creating turbine engines for planes. And you might have heard people creating houses and that type of structure, which is now a functional use of the technology. So the essential steps required for 3D printing, and this is for any type of 3D printing, not necessarily focused on FDM, you have to start off with a CAD model. So a lot of time, so I work for a company called The Printing House, and one of the applications that we do there is we have a scanning booth with 120 cameras where we can scan you and create a 3D model of yourself printed in color. And we get requests from people that, can that be done from picture? And the answer is yes and no. The in order for us to create any kind of physical object using 3D printing, we need to have a 3D model. So if we have pictures, we can get one of the designers to create a 3D model, but 2D image is just not enough information to create a 3D model. So you need to start from a 3D model. That's step one. Step two is to generate an STL format. STL stands for stereolithography. This was developed in the early stages of 3D printing in 1983 when Charles Hull, the founder of 3D Systems, developed the first SLA machine, stereolithography apparatus number one. He had to develop a language that the 3D printer understands, and which was named as STL. And this is the format that's used till day for any type of 3D printing technology. Keep in mind, STL does not contain any color information. It's only a mesh of your file. So if you are looking to produce something that has full color, you might need to move on to different formats. But those printers are still able to produce in monochrome using the STL technology. So STL is widely used. Third step, which was very essential to our research, it's the slicing process of your 3D model. So the way 3D works, again, it's layer upon layer. And at step three, you take that 3D model that you have created, and then you slice it down so it has cross sections of your model, as you can see in number three. The fourth step is just sending the information to your printer, similar to you would do that to your 2D printer, and then you just press print and let the machine do the work. Step five is a post-process. The post-process could include removing of the support structure, which was built during the time of the build. So anywhere you have complex shapes, curves, features, the machine might deposit a support material. And this is typically generated by the machine. You can optimize this process as well, but most machines come with the software that is equipped to that equipment only, and they develop a support material structure for your part. The other process can include polishing, painting, that type of application that can be done after you produce your parts. In the end, you will have a finished product. What we're focusing on is process parameter, which lies within step number three when we're slicing those files. You might know there's many different 3D printers available. There's different technologies, different processes. You can print in laser sintering to produce metal parts. You can print in photopolymers, liquid resins. But what we're focused on, and our research was around, was on material extrusion process for fused deposition modeling. So it stands for FDM. So the way FDM works, and the simple way to understand this is if you think about a glue gun, it melts material and deposits one layer upon another. Once the material, the first layer is cooled down, it deposits the second layer, then deposits the third layer until you have a finished part. In this case, you see two different extruders, one for model material and the other one for support. The model is the yellow material and the support is the gray material. And as I mentioned in the past, support material is required anywhere you have complex shapes, so that way it can hold up its structural integrity. For our experiment, what we focused on was process parameter for build orientation. So in 3D printing, we discovered that building in a correct format of the orientation is very essential in terms of reducing the cost as well as the time reduction. We paired that up with air gap between material that is being deposited as well as the thickness of the material that's getting deposited. And that can be controlled with the speed of your production. So the faster you're trying to produce, the thinner the material is going to get. And then the air gap can be configured using different softwares. We use these two models, the articulated rod and suspension rod. This is a 3D CAD model that was generated in a software called SolidWorks. We then exported that into a STL format. We developed a cost formula. The cost of build was calculated based on the material lifetime and how much it cost us in production time per hour, as well as the cost of material that we're using, both model and support. We used a software called Insight, which was available for the machine that we utilized, which was Fortis 900MC. It's an FDM machine by Stratasys. And this was their software that we utilized called Insight 9.0. So for our design of experiment, we considered different orientation from 0 degrees to 40 degrees to 90 degrees. We also kept in mind what is the minimum air gap we can have and the maximum air gap we can have, as well as the minimum thickness of the material and the maximum thickness of the material. And this is enabled by specific machine. So each machine has its own tolerance on how thin and how thick you can produce your material. So in the FDM machine Fortis 900, we had certain parameters that we could control in their software. So the raster width, the thickness of the material that we controlled, was from minimum being 0.016 to 0.022 inch. And the air gap, we wanted to see the overlapping of materials, so we went to negative 0.001 and positive 0.022. So this would decrease any kind of air gap you would have being in the negative, so there would be an overlap of the material versus having lots of air gap. The results were very promising. We did it for the articulated rod as well as for the suspension arm. You can see this is a sliced model. The gray material you see right here, this is a sport structure. You can see a significant increase in the 90 degree of sport material, as well as the height of production that it would take. 40 degrees, yeah, there was increase, but also it wasn't as significant as 90. But we wanted to see that into a graphical form. We wanted to see exactly how much material was being used. So this was the result. So by having maximum surface area on 0 degree on the print bed, having the maximum air gap and the minimum thickness of the material resulted in promising results. We were able to, and that was a scenario for both of the experiments that we conducted. As you can see, just the time alone, using a 90 degree control, you're looking at about 822 minutes to produce a part. And by optimizing the cost process, it was down to only 143. So not only are you saving on time, but also material as well as the production of the part. Graphically, you can see we were saving over 50% in cost. That's a huge chunk. So those are some of the things that we have to consider. So when dealing with parts with FDM, we have to verify, is this going to be used for a functional test or is it going to be just for fit and feel? If it's fit and feel, it makes no sense to create the part in solid because you're increasing time and cost. And cost drives everything. These are the finished products. So these were 3D printed using that process parameter. And inside, the structure is honeycomb type. I have some examples in the poster presentation area. So when you guys do come around, I will show you. You can see the significant difference in weight, but the surface quality is still there. It doesn't jeopardize with the surface quality. Thank you very much. The whole report is published with ASME, so you can get access to that. But if you do have any questions, the floor is now open.